Welcome and thank you for joining us today. This is our first of a series of industry panels that we'll be hosting this spring semester. So we're very excited that you're here. But before we get started, I did want to pass it over and invite Dr. Sprega to come in and say a few words.
Well, thank you. Welcome everyone, and a pleasure for us to host you for this. You're going to be exposed to a panel of experts, and it's going to be a very valuable session. We're very grateful to them for giving up their time and their talent to be with us and share with us their stories. The STEM field, as you know, in general, is something that's alive and well across the United States. It attracts a lot of attention for grants and federal funding and all kinds of activities because of the importance of those STEM fields in the workplace. But in particular, area of in the biological area, biolife and biotech, these are areas that Bristol Community College has been very involved in. We have new programs coming in this field, as well as existing programs and our existing majors for students. And then move on what we call articulation agreements, where you can graduate from Bristol, and then it's articulated, it's agreed upon, that you would then move to another school. It doesn't have to, University of Massachusetts at Dartmouth, Bridgewater, but certainly it doesn't have to be just in this region if you're interested across the country. If we don't have articulation agreements with the school you're interested in, we will make them. We will contact the school and forge the, make sure that the agreement is created. So there's a great deal of attraction in this field. I encourage you, you've expressed an interest in it. I encourage you to keep going in that field, move into higher education, and the world is really a dream for you afterwards. So please keep that in mind. Keep Bristol in mind. We're glad to help you any way we can. And we have an expert guide here, Megan, to take you through the various options and various possibilities that are open to you. So take advantage of them. And again, welcome. And I know you'll enjoy the day at Bristol. Thank you.
Thank you, Megan.
Well, again, my name is Megan Abella Bowen. I'm the Associate Dean for Science, Technology, Engineering, and Math here at the college. And my colleague and I, Jennifer Deckers-Mitchell, we've been working to put these panel discussions together for our students throughout this spring semester. So we're starting off with what we think is going to be a very exciting presentation today, and really encouraging you to think about questions, take the opportunity to ask these experts in the field how they got into the field, why they, what they do, you know, what are the options, how can you move into those fields. Hopefully all of you picked up one of the bio sheets for each of them, and if you look at the bio sheets, what you're going to see is they all followed a very, very different path to how they got into their field. And I think many times students, whether you are a traditional age student just coming in, or you're a non-traditional student who's coming back and rethinking your career option, you think, oh my gosh, I need to make the right decisions, I've got to start study the right thing so that I can go down that path. The reality is, how do you use those skill sets that you gain through your education? How do you market those skill sets? How do you transfer them to go where you want to go? And I think some of the stories you're going to hear today are from folks who are going to show you how they were able to transfer those skill sets into the biotechnology and into the bioengineering fields. Secondly, also, many times students think, well, what's the difference between biotech and bioengineering? You're going to have a nice group of speakers today who are going to talk from the biomedical side of the house, the bioengineering side of the house, the pharma side of the house. So really take your opportunities to talk with these folks, ask questions. Our goal will be to basically do two speakers at a time. After the first two speakers, we're going to open it up to questions. So if you have questions, please don't hesitate. Jen will probably, just for sake if you can't hear, she may repeat the questions before we have our panelists answer them. and we'll just go from there. And then at the end of the presentation today, or at the end of the panel discussion, we'll open it up for any question to any of the panelists at that time. Also, if you don't need to rush out right at the end, take a few minutes to talk with our panelists, get to know a little bit more about them, make sure this is a great networking opportunity, something that I don't think our students always take full advantage of. You need to start making your contacts now while you're in college. Those of you who are in high school, start making those contacts now. Find out what people are doing in the industry. So it just helps you to make more informed decisions as you go along. So with that, I am going to pass it over. I'm going to have our first speaker, I'm going to introduce our first speaker, pardon me. They wrote small. So our first speaker is Derek Tiago. Did I say it correctly? Derek Tiago. He's currently a senior product development engineer at DePuy Synthes MyTech Sports Medical Medicine. He's supporting visualization equipment for minimally invasive arthroscopic surgery and endoscopy. And the key thing that I wanted to make sure that you all have this so you can read everything, but the key thing is I want to let you know, Derek is he was a graduate of Votech. He came to BCC, did our two-year program here at Bristol Community College. He transferred on to UMass Dartmouth, where he received his bachelor's in mechanical engineering and has continuing his education as he's gone along. So I'm going to start off and pass it over to Derek. Oh, you can stay right there. I'm sorry. We have...
I'd rather stay.
Oh, you'd rather stay?
Yeah, help please. Yourself. Is this testing? Yes. Thank you, everybody. Thank you for coming. Very ironic. It's tough to prepare to speak about yourself. I mean, it's something that should come naturally, but frankly, growing up, I was always the type of kid that, I mean, I didn't have many toys, but I would always take them apart. It used to drive my mom crazy because I would never be able to put them back together. But I always had a knack for wondering, what makes something itself, right? So what's the inner workings of my PlayStation? What was the inner workings of, a little toy car? So when I hit eighth grade, I ventured out. I checked out the local Volk school. I checked out the local high school. And I found that New Bedford Volk had an engineering technology program, and they had an awesome exploratory program, so you got to spend 4.5 days in certain shops, and I kind of fell into it. I thought I found my niche, you know? And I took the four-year program there. I really felt comfortable in the shop, so 9 days shop, 9 days academics, and I really took a liking to it, and I gave it my all. And when I graduated, I actually graduated top of my shop, and my name was placed in the paper. So all the students that placed, top in academics or top in shop, there was a nice write-up in the New York Times, and there was a local manufacturing company that my father had a good relationship with, and they reached out to my dad, and they said, hey, we saw your son is an engineering student, does he want to work for us? So, I was 18 years old, kind of thrown into the fire, not really expecting what, the professional aspect of the job would be. And I worked there all through my studies at BCC and UMass Dartmouth. So like there, I started off as just a shop floor tech. I ran some equipment, I ran a wired EM, I ran some conventional mills, conventional lathes. I had a good drafting background, so I started drafting all of the prints for the custom device department. And like throughout my studies, I started learning more about materials, learning more about the differences in stainless steel, aluminum, titanium, how to make them, why you can't weld titanium, certain things like that. And throughout my time there, I started getting more and more responsibility. When I graduated BCC, one of our engineers there, he wasn't working out, and they offered me a full-time job supporting the custom device department. So. Through my studies at UMass, I had a full-time job, full-time education, and I was kind of overwhelmed, but I learned a lot. I managed through it, and it placed me in a really good position for continuing my professional career, because we did a lot of work for local manufacturers, we did a lot of work for some big OEMs, and I built a lot of good relationships with these companies. So it was a small 60-person shop. I found that I wouldn't get to be where I wanted to be there, and I moved on to a company called Symmetry Medical. They were a local manufacturing company. I was a process engineer there, so I supported a lot of manufacturing of different types of medical devices. I found that working on the shop floor wasn't my thing. I knew how to make stuff. I had a good background in making stuff. But I really wanted to get on the front end of it and work in design. So I ended up applying out to a local OEM, so DePuy MyTech. They're a division of Johnson & Johnson. And I started there as an entry-level design engineer. And there I kind of learned that manufacturing of a product is a very small aspect of product development. And you know, I was able to learn that through product development, there's multiple cycles. There's the aspect of coming up with a concept, right? So taking something and just working in white space. Nothing currently exists in the market, and you need to come up with a surgical solution that's better, smaller, faster than some of your competitors. From concept, you take things into feasibility. So, you know, does your concept work, right? Is it going to generate revenue? Can you make it? Can you make it in-house? Can you make it, you know, at external manufacturers? And then taking things through development. So now that you have a design, right, will it work in, you know, all the different bone qualities of different patients, right? Does it work in adolescents? Does it work in adults? Kind of getting the feel for the edges of your design. And then lastly, once you have your design, verify and validate and launch it for commercial use. So, I mean, that's my background. Education-wise, BCC gave me a great start. Having that position, you know, at Five Star, the local company, it really helped put the academics into play. The transfer program itself, I was impressed at how smooth it was. I did duplicate some classes. It was my own choice. I knew that some classes didn't transfer. As President mentioned, there's a really good agreement with the local universities, so I strongly encourage if anybody is going to transfer to get a hold of you know, the matrices of the classes here at BCC and the corresponding classes at the university you're going to transfer to. There were classes like thermodynamics that I had heard such bad things about and that it was going to be so difficult. You know, they offered it here, I took it here, I knew it didn't transfer, but it kind of set me up for success. When you're working full-time and taking five classes, you kind of want all the help you can get, right? So having a good background coming out of here, it was really a layup for me going to UMass. And again, I commend the school for, you know, the wonderful agreement that they had and the easy transfer. That's a snapshot about me and my background. I'm going to pass it over, and then if you have any specific questions, we'll cover it in the Q&A. Thank you.
Thank you. So our next speaker is Stanford Lynch. He joined Mass Biologics in 2005 as a manufacturing technician one in the vaccine fill and finish department. I'm gonna let him give you his background of the pathway that he took through there. But one of the key things, again, if you look at the bottom down here, you'll see that Stan graduated from Hyde Park High School in 1999. He received an associate's degree in animation from Gibbs Boston in 2013. He's worked in the pet industry from 1990 to 2007, and Stan also worked in the produce department at Super Stop and Shop. So again, Stan's gonna probably give you a little bit of an idea of a very non-traditional path into the biotechnology field.
Yes, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Can you hear me? Yes, I started basically loving animals. So I always loved animals. So I've been in the pet industry for over, I want to say, 10 plus years, working in Petco, Pet Supplies Plus, working around animals, basically in the aquarium department, working with basically dogs, cats, everything. I also did a little bit of medicine stuff in the part where animals actually transact from the farms into the pet industry where they need to get the shots and so forth. So I also liked taking care of animals, and when I found out that Mass Biology was around, and that therefore I could actually not just help animals, but I could actually help humans also, I was like, whoa, that's something different. But I was like, should I actually go there and do this? It felt kind of weird at first, because I'm like, I'm working with animals, but now I'm working at Mass Biology with a vaccine that people get injected with, which is like, it was scary at first for me. After being there for 2 years, it became natural. you're out there to help people and, you know, give them the opportunity to help be healthy and also basically find a new path and a new medicine to help the human race. You know, so at Mass Biologic, we work with a tedious tetanus theta vaccine. So we basically fill it, package it. I work on the upstream and downstream. So basically, I do visual inspection of the product. I also do the packaging of the product and also help out the shipping part of the product. If we go back in the past, I started basically at Stop and Shop first as a produce department guy. And going for my college degree wise, pushed me. Stop and Shop used to kind of push us around all the time, ship us from here to here. And I was like, I can't be doing this no more. I'm like, I need a new career or something different in my life. So I decided to go to Gibbs Boston because I also love art and I also love drawing. So I was like, I decided to go there for a 2-year associate degree. And I got that there and it felt good. But I feel like there was more to it. And a coworker of mine from Mass Biologic told me about this. He's working in the pet industry with me, saying, hey, Mass Biologic is hiring. And that's how I got in there. So I started basically having no background in, say, science or the biotech industry. But it's a easy program to kind of follow if you have your heart into it, saying you know what you need in life to succeed and know that you're looking to help others. The biotech industry is a good place for that. Other than that, I mean, if any questions later on, feel free to ask. Mass Biologic is located in Boston on 460 Walk Hill Street in Mattapan, Mass. And we also have another facility in Fall River right now also, next to the big new Amazon facility that's being built.
Does Mass Biologics offer any type of continuing education
if I remember correctly, we do. We also have connection to all the department schools like UMass Boston, and we also do like a tuition reimbursement. Yes.
Thank you.
Welcome.
What vaccines have you worked on that we might be aware of?
Okay.
We work with the TD vaccine, the tetanus theta vaccine. We also do contract manufacturing, and we recently prepared, filled, and shipped out the latest flu vaccine, Flublok.
Sort of a comment and then a question. When you hear biotech, kind of you think of biology stuff, right? But as Derek's presentation illustrated, and as you think, you know, when you hear the presentation from Primo, you realize that it's really both the device side as well as the biologic side, right? So if your skill set is in the biologic science, there's a career opportunity for you. But if you're a cutting tool person, if you're a chipper and a maker and you like working with physical product, right? Tiago's story is your story. Because you can, so that's the statement, right? But I want to ask both of them. I hope this will answer for both of you. If you don't have the right answer, I'll spit it out later. I know Frank will know it. But why is it a big deal, this opportunity of biotech in Massachusetts?
Why is biotech in Massachusetts such a big deal? Right? That's the question.
Any clues, any reaction to that?
Well, so I can talk to my industry. So, I mean, I support sports medicine, and anybody that watches football knows that every week somebody's tearing an ACL. So with these modern progressions in medicine, you know, in the past, meniscal repairs, surgeons would remove meniscus from a patient. Now we have, you know, modern technologies with small size sutures and small implants so that you can actually repair the meniscus. And, you know, meniscus tears in different areas can heal itself, or you rely on suture the rest of your life. So biotech's so big right now because with all of these, you know, cutting edge technologies for, especially in my area, sports medicine, we're understanding more and more as to why people are you know, becoming injured. And in the past, there weren't a lot of solutions to repair these types of injuries, and now there are, right? And the more we learn, right, the more we're able to help the public, and we're able to help these athletes and cure these injuries.
Well, to add to that, you know how there's all the different viruses out there and so forth. So biotech is kind of like, say, that shield to try and avoid these from getting worse. So the medicine that we create is kind of saying, we try to make it better. So for example, the flu block, there's different strain of the flu out there. So the flu block that we worked on is basically supposed to be the best flu block out there for anyone at the flu season. So biotech industry, like Mass Biologic, we strive to get, you know, the best medicine out there.
Okay, so just to complete the thought, those are great answers. And that where I was driving is that you already hear about jobs going out of America and everything can make anything anywhere, right? But why the life science industry is anchored in Massachusetts is somewhat place-based. And what that means is that how many of you deal with the Boston hospitals, right? The kind of science that the Boston hospitals are among the best in the world, with Harvard and MIT and UMass and Northeastern and Tufts, in this tiny, tiny state, you've got this global concentration of intellectual excellence and manufacturing and production excellence, right? So for people who live in Massachusetts, this is a layup, right? You can drive to most of these places within an hour, except in traffic. But that's the point I'm trying to make. You know, life science is a big deal because of the hospitals and because of the industry that grew out of working with the doctors to make new tools and hips and artificial limbs and so forth. So that's kind of what I was trying to tease out, that this is a place-based experience for Massachusetts. So it's a great opportunity, and you can do internships and work while you're in school.
I think we had one more question in the audience, and then we'll move on with our speakers. Just a note, there will be more opportunity for Q&A, so please write down what you're thinking.
Okay. Yeah. Hi. So this is for both of your companies. Just a question. Obviously, living wage and wage equality is a big conversation piece going on right now, thankfully, for women and for minorities. I'm curious what your companies are doing as a social responsibility to us. In that conversation, is there a bubbling for in the, you know, new stuff for us and for minorities?
Yeah, I'll take the first stab. So, you know, Johnson & Johnson is a big company. We're big into having local affinity groups that help, you know, different diverse backgrounds. We have, you know, several affinity groups in our facility in Raynham. That support women's leadership initiatives, AALC, the African American Learning Committee. We have a group of millennials, so like young professionals, helping up and coming, you know, new engineers that are new to the industry. So all of these different affinity groups that we have, they help bring in people of said background, right? They don't discriminate across, you know, who they help, but you have some, so I'm in the young professionals group, and I mean, I kind of relate well with, you know, the young 19, 20 year old interns. And so we have, you know, mentoring program to help bring them up and to share your experience with them and kind of help guide them through, you know, your learning. So within those affinity groups is how our building tries to drive, you know, learning and just basically fostering a culture of learning within the workplace.
At Mass Biologic, we consider ourselves as family, at least in my department, and we're very diverse. We have from Ethiopian, I'm a Jamaican, we have Dominicans, variety, ladies, gentlemen, and we consider ourselves family. We work together well, and we socialize well. We all sit at a big breakfast table at lunch and breakfast. Other department comes in and look at us like, because we pretty much seems like we're running the whole show there, you know. So we don't kind of just say, "Hey, I work here in this department, so you over there, you over there." Because we all do the same thing, and we all need each other. Because we work, we verify each other and everything. So therefore, we kind of basically that we compete with each other, trust each other, and, you know, respect each other. So we're always, you know, all around doing things together. We have potluck, I usually host that. And we're gonna, at least when we have at least some downtime from production, I like to do that. We host a potluck, we get together, we eat, we enjoy, and we laugh and have fun. Welcome.
Great. All right, we're gonna move on to our next two speakers. Our next speaker is Frank Fazio. Frank is also with Mass Biologics. He's the Deputy Director for Manufacturing for Mass Biologics of the University of Massachusetts Medical School. He has over 25 years of experience in manufacture of medical devices, diagnostics, and biologics. He holds a patent for a system of removing, fluid from blood. In addition, Frank received his Bachelor's of Science degree in biology from Framingham State University, his MBA from Anna Maria College, and he holds a Master's of Science in Work Environment from the University of Massachusetts in Lowell. I will introduce Frank.
Hi, thank you. So I am the Deputy Director of Manufacturing at Mass Biologics, and kind of what I do there, it may be a bit misleading. So I'm responsible for the manufacturing, engineering, and manufacturing technical support for Mass Biologics. We have three different arms. We have our production arm, our manufacturing support arm, and our engineering arm. And in production, the production department is where we manufacture all of the commercial biologic medicines, as well as all of our investigational medicines. Currently, the commercial medicine is a tetanus diphtheria vaccine that Stan spoke about. We manufacture about a third of the tetanus diphtheria vaccine that's distributed here in the U.S. We currently are actually distributing vaccine in Australia due to a shortfall in the supply in Australia. We were able to help them and supply them with a medicine to close a gap in the supply. On the investigational side, we have a pipeline of various monoclonal antibodies. So we have a monoclonal antibody to rabies, we have a monoclonal antibody to hepatitis C, and we have a monoclonal antibody to the toxins associated with C. difficile. And those are all in different stages of the clinical the path to commercialization. We've recently started a new platform. Those medicines are all monoclonal antibodies, kind of the typical biologic type medicines that we're all used to. Therapeutic proteins that go in and perform some sort of therapy to people and provide some sort of therapeutic benefit for the patient. Now we're working with a platform where we're looking to deliver the gene to the individual to create the biologic medicine within yourself. So patients can receive a gene, and the gene will allow that patient to manufacture the therapeutic protein within themselves as essentially the person being the bioreactor, and being able to relieve the disease condition through that addition of the gene. All of that work, all of the manufacturing work is done under what's called current good manufacturing practices. And there's an entire section of the federal registration that describes how you have to manufacture medicines. These medicines are all too large and too sensitive to sterilize after you manufacture them. So you have to manufacture them in a way that prevents contamination. You have to manufacture them in a way that retains the consistency of the effectiveness of the medicine, so that they're potent and that they're effective when they reach the patient. So the work that Stan described that he does is all done under this very, very elaborate system of control and documentation that it takes a lot of discipline and a lot of acclimation to be able to work under those bodies of controls. And in order to support all that, we also have our engineering department. So I'm responsible for all the manufacturing engineering, the facilities engineering, and some of the scale up or the tech transfer as we get products that move from process development into manufacturing. So in order to manufacture these medicines, you know, a key ingredient in a lot of this stuff is water. And you can't just take water from city water and turn it into a vaccine. So, you know, we have a what's called a water for injection system, where we manufacture 35 gallons of water for injection a minute. And what we have to do is we have to take pure steam, and we have to condense it into water for injection. And anybody who knows anything about water knows that once you have this moist environment, bacteria and all kinds of microbes love to grow in that water. So we have to maintain that water at about 90 degrees C. So, you know, we have a 1,500 gallon tank, stainless steel tank of water for injection at 90 degrees C, which obviously is just below boiling. So you can imagine some of the engineering challenges associated with managing a tank of 1,500 gallons, distributing that water all through the plant in a safe way, and in a way that maintains the quality of that water. So we have a kind of a, you know, a body of engineers and facility technicians who are going through all the systems, constantly looking at the pumps, repairing the pumps, maintaining the heat exchangers, maintaining the chillers, and that sort of thing. There's a huge engineering effort behind the manufacturing process. And in addition to that, we also have the distribution process. So water being a huge, significant ingredient, you also have all the other ingredients that need to be, that you need. Salt, you know, sodium chloride. People purchase sodium chloride from a variety of places. Well, in order for us to be able to use that sodium chloride, we have to make sure that it meets the specification that we said we needed in order to manufacture the medicine. So, you know, the sodium chloride has a specific set of requirements that must be met in order for it to be accepted into the plant. The QC folks go, they sample it, they do all the necessary testing to prove that it meets all those specifications, and then we're able to accept it. And then we have to hold it, right? So we have to warehouse it in a specific way. You can't just put sodium chloride in a damp, you know, basement. So we have to maintain the environment around the warehouse. We have, you know, several about 40,000 square feet of warehouse space. Some of it ambient, some of it refrigerated, some of it warm, some of it frozen. And that space is all what's called qualified and validated, where we've actually taken and mapped, temperature mapped the entire area and maintained the temperature of that area within a specified range. So there's a lot that goes into the manufacture of a therapeutic. There's a lot that goes into the manufacture of a medicine. Paul brought up the point that we're kind of at this hub, and the inertia and the infrastructure we have here in the Northeast really is incredible, because you have all these cutting edge scientists doing work in some of the premier research institutes in the world right here in this area. Well, those ideas and those things are great, but in order for them to be turned into or translated into a medicine, you need all the traditional types of engineering, process development, manufacturing technologies that we have in this area. If you think about being able to control the temperature of a, you know, 1,500 gallons of water, well, you need very sophisticated automated controls to be able to maintain that water at the right temperature without creating a situation where you're going to boil it inside a tank and create, you know, this giant pressure problem. And those types of technologies, that type of infrastructure, exists here in the Northeast. The engineering talent associated, you know, with being able to implement those automation techniques exists here. So what happens is when you have that inertia, you're able to create these areas of jobs. And these are pretty good jobs. These are jobs that pay well. They're responsible jobs. They're jobs that have a very high level of self-actualization. You feel very good about doing these jobs, and they stay. You know, so I think it's a very important way to build the infrastructures here. You attract more of those organizations, and you create kind of this cycle where you can keep advancing medicine. You know, this idea of creating gene therapies for commercial use is pretty novel. There's only one gene therapy medicine approved right now in Europe. So it's very, very novel, it's very, very new, and if we're able to do that here in this region. You know, how I got here, I have a degree in biology. I ended up later with an MBA and a Master of Science in Engineering. But I did all that, you know, while I was working. You know, so it's really a lot of work to be able to work full-time, attend those classes, you know, get the additional degrees. But you build out that body of knowledge that you need, and you eventually can achieve kind of the ultimate goal that you want to achieve.
All right. Our next speaker is Michael Nestroud. He's the manager of global sensory science at Ocean Spray Cranberries Incorporated. So I think a lot of times you're thinking biotech, bioengineering, and food doesn't come to mind. And so I'm very excited that he's going to be here talking about some of the different things that Ocean Spray does. I don't think many people realize all the opportunities there. But anyhow, he manages a team of four research scientists and technicians to run consumer taste tests, both globally and locally. I've actually been lucky enough to do some of their taste testing, which is quite good fun. Michael has an AOS in Culinary Arts from the Culinary Institute of America, and both a BS and a PhD degree in food sciences and sensory sciences from Cornell University. In 2001, he completed a postdoc at the U.S. Army Natick Research, Development, and Engineering Center, where his research focused on designing optimal menus for Army field rations. So quite an interesting background.
So I'm going to start out by being a little interactive, and I want to tell you how I got to what I'm doing, because I think that it's a very windy path, and I had no idea at each step of the way what was next. So I grew up in Little Rock, Arkansas. So what's one word that comes to mind when you think of Arkansas?
Conservative.
Clinton. Conservative now, maybe not in the 90s. What else?
Country.
Clinton again. So the word for me is hot.
Razorbacks?
Yeah, thank you. College football, that's a huge one. Hot. And growing up, you know those like couple weeks in August when it's 90 degrees or 95 degrees outside and you got like 95% humidity and it sucks? Yeah, that's like 4 or 5 months out of the year in Arkansas. And even I lived there for 18 years and I never got used to it. So I picked a lot of indoor activities for myself. And growing up in mid, late 80s, early 90s, one of those was computers. This was the PC revolution at the time. You know, I'll totally date myself, but we had a IBM 8088, which is the first home PC that ever existed. And Derek, I took it apart and put it back together, and it still worked. And the other big indoor activity for me was food. I loved cooking. I loved helping people in the sense through food. And I, you know, followed those two passions through high school. You know, through computers, I learned pre-internet how to use your modem and call out and talk to people around the world. Now we can just tweet things and get responses from all over the world, but that was a big deal back then. And that was fascinating to me. And on the food end, I, you know, when I wasn't doing that up in my room, hold up, I was tinkering around in the kitchen. Around the time I was 16 years old, I realized I had to figure out what I wanted to do, and I thought I had to make a decision for the rest of my life. And I thought, well, I don't know how you're going to make money in food, so I might as well do computers, because this is 1998, and this was the first dot-com boom before the first dot-com crash, and so programming was really hot. I tinkered around with a little of it. And so I did that. Went to Georgia Tech for 2 years, well, ended up being 2 years, and studied computer science. One of the questions that Jennifer sent me, or I guess us, before we came here today was, did you ever think about quitting? And my response to that was, well, yeah, after about 2.5 years, I thought about it and I did quit. But before I did that, I figured out what I reassessed what I wanted to do, getting out of Arkansas, I started to learn what are the other things that I'm passionate about and how could I make those work for myself. And I learned about food science at the time. Didn't know it existed, even though Arkansas does have a good food science program. Just growing up, I had no idea. And I also, as I dug into that, learned that a lot of food scientists, and I'll explain what a food scientist is, but a lot of food scientists don't know a lot about how food should taste. If you taste a lot of manufactured food out there, you kind of get that. It's a whole lot better now than it used to be. So in roughly 2001, 2002, I dropped all my classes one semester, applied to culinary school, and then called my parents and told them what I did. which was the first big decision I ever made for myself, so that's why I did it that way. Ended up going to culinary school up in New York. That got me to the north. Absolutely, one, loved the weather after being in Atlanta and Little Rock. Loved the weather up north. And loved culinary school. And one of the things I did there is I knew I wanted to do food science, but I gave myself the opportunity to fall in love with that. And what I did was a two-year degree, the most physically demanding thing, if anyone's ever worked in kitchens, that you'll ever do in your life is work in kitchens. Most pressure I've ever been under. You know, anything I have to deal with now that's pressure-oriented is easy compared to that. But I stayed on and taught there for a year and slowed down and took stock of, gave myself a chance to fall in love with it. At the same time, I took classes at a nearby community college that would allow me to go into food science if I wanted to. And that's what, after teaching there for a year, that's what I did, is I applied to a food science program, still didn't quite know what food science was, and started trying to figure out what that path would look like. Food science is a catch-all major. So UMass Amherst has an excellent, excellent food science program. Framingham State has an excellent food science program. I'm not sure if any of the schools around here have a specific food science program, but you don't have to be a by title food science major to do food science, and a lot aren't. But food science is everything from what I do, which is the taste side, sensory science is the taste side, to the chemistry of food, to the manufacturing of food, to the physical processes. Frank talked about pressure and tanks, and that's a big part of what we do. We manufacture, Frank mentioned sterile manufacturing. Ocean Spray was the first to put juice in a sterile process in juice boxes in the world back in the early 80s. And that's why we still make all the juice boxes for Juicy Juice right now, because of the development of that process that was invented here, along with a company called Tetra Pak. So there's a lot. Food science is this world of how do you get food from where it, in the case of Ocean Spray, this living thing in the ground, to what is this living thing in the bottle. Because of my background, and by the way, when I left Georgia Tech, I thought I was never going to touch computer science the same way again. When I got to Cornell, I started working with a sensory science professor because I thought the taste was really interesting. And sensory science is the science of measuring taste. And I quickly realized that the measurement of people's taste preferences is applied math. And by that, you're gathering lots and lots of data from people. You're soliciting, you're sending questionnaires, you're putting products in front of people, eliciting feedback, and then you have to calculate the results. And as varied as the preferences are in this room, if I asked each of y'all what your favorite beverage or food was, is the results we get back, but we have to create some sort of consistent picture of that. And so it's the way to do that is with math and statistics. And so that bridged, that built on that knowledge that I had built all throughout grade school, high school on my own, and then once I got to Georgia Tech on the computational side, which was fascinating to me. And so I used that and leveraged that throughout my undergrad and graduate career to really focus on honing that computational statistics side of my background, which is still what I do today, essentially. I made my way to Natick, which is what brought my wife and I to Massachusetts, and helped them work on MRE menus. The way that came about is that I had partnered with Natick Labs for my postdoc work and sent surveys out to warfighters around the world to understand their preferences for MRE menus. And we did some really good work to, who's had MREs, by the way? Did you like them?
They were edible.
They were edible? Good. Yeah, good, no. Who had MREs pre about 1987? That's a better question. Anyone in this room?
C-Racks.
Yeah. Were those edible?
Not really.
Not really. So there was a big revolution in the MREs are Army Field Rations, with these packets of an entire 2,500 calorie meal that has a 2-year shelf life. Talk about an engineering challenge. Taking living things, I mean, food's living, right? And give it a 2-year shelf life in a way that still maintains the nutrition and health benefits of it. And ship that around the world. Drop it from 40,000 feet with a parachute, and you have to realize these aren't like human parachutes. A human would die if they used one of these types of parachutes, because they still hit the ground going like 90, 100 miles an hour, just enough to not break them. So then they have to still then maintain everything they're supposed to with this packaging system, the food delivery system, and deliver hot food to warfighters wherever they are, as well as the humanitarian wing of those. So that's a fascinating, fascinating engineering problem. Taste problem, technology problem. So worked on that for about a year. And then someone who had, and you talk about random connections and networking, someone who had seen me speak at a conference 3 years prior out in California found me on LinkedIn. If you're not on LinkedIn, get on LinkedIn. Just randomly sent me a note and said, hey, what are you doing in Massachusetts? Can I take you out to lunch? I said, sure, why not? And that turned into about a year and a half long opportunity to build a work at a startup firm in market research and help them build a sensory science practice, which was a really, really cool experience. It was about 30 people, cutting edge math and statistics work, again, on the market research side, very computational heavy. And then after about a year and a half of that, made my way to Ocean Spray. You know, as I was sitting and asking myself the same question about 3 weeks ago, is like, is Ocean Spray really biotech? And then, you know, over the past 3 weeks and sitting here, I'm like, absolutely. The fact that we are taking living things, living cranberries, and putting them in a bottle, still living, but in a way that's nutritious, in a way that's safe for people, it's all technology. It's all math and science. Now one of the main focuses of Ocean Spray is around the health benefits of the cranberry and really leveraging that. And so the health benefits are based on living molecules in living things in the juice, and I don't mean like bacteria, but proteins, polyphenols, these biologic compounds that change over time. Polyphenols, by the way, as a taste person, they taste terrible. So we're trying to concentrate the healthy parts of the cranberry, but they taste awful, and I shouldn't say that. They have a challenging taste profile that we must overcome. but yet create products that people love. You know, the product development process, again, Derek mentioned concept feasibility, verify, validate, launch. That's our process too. That's exactly what we do. We build concepts. Is this feasible? What's the technological challenge? Crazins, which everyone here knows what crazins are. It was a engineering solution which turned crazins from this lab scale thing that was extremely cost inefficient to produce. And so people were doing it, but certainly not on the scale that we're able to do. It was an engineer that had worked in a completely different industry who came to Ocean Spray and said, hey, I think that we can do that better. And around 1987, 88, he helped invent a process that we put in place at the Middleborough plant that allowed us to not only produce dried cranberries, but use the outcome of that as the juice for our juices. Whereas previously, when we tried to make dried cranberries, it was a whole inclusive process where we had to throw away the juice that was done at, juice that came out of it. So now, craisins are what they are. It's a $500 million a year business around the world in 97, 98 countries. So, you know, absolutely, that's depending on what your focus is, what your interests are, you know, food science is a potential place for you, whether it's ocean spray, whether it's on the math statistics side of STEM, whether it's on the biological side of STEM, whether it's on the engineering side of STEM. There's companies everywhere doing really great things out there.
All right, does anybody have any questions for Frank or Michael? Yes. So, MassBiologics, are you contracted by organizations to develop the vaccines?
To manufacture
the vaccines? Yeah.
So we do both. The antibodies that I mentioned, the rabies, the HCV, and the C. difficile, were all internal programs that we discovered, developed, and actually brought through the clinical development process. We also do contract manufacturing for other organizations that have antibodies. Unfortunately, a lot of those, I gotta keep confidentiality around what's going on there because they're in their development processes. But we've worked on antibodies that really have a profound effect on some very debilitating diseases. And you really feel pretty good when you manufacture something and you finally load the truck with all these little vials of stuff that is going to go somewhere and help people with very severe diseases. So it's a very satisfying kind of activity. So we do both. We have our own pipeline. We have a discovery group that is about 25 or 30 people strong. I think there's about 8 or 9 PhD level people in that group. They employ people from PhD level to the associates and bachelor's level. We have a development group. It's about 45 people strong. Same thing, there's about a dozen PhDs in that group. And we also have people with bachelor's and associate's degrees in that group. The development group also has places for people with high school diplomas, doing some of the support activities associated with the development process itself. So we've historically done it in mice. Yeah. So the Humab mice and great tool. We've also worked on some novel ways of doing it. We haven't used the yeast platform. We've used B cells. So patient B cells and isolated antibodies that way. So it's kind of, you know, we'll take the advantage of whatever opportunity presents itself to us. But yeah, that's a great level.
Any other questions? Don't be shy. Yes,
just ask all of them. Websites, is there career opportunity listed on your websites and what the website addresses?
Well, if you connect with me, I'd be more than happy to provide you with the website addresses. But yeah, are career opportunities listed on your websites?
Yes.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
I just have a question about for all the speakers. If we have students who are currently doing another job and going to school, do you encourage them to at least reach out to you and kind of inquire? I know, like, do you have shifts that maybe are second shift or third shift or weekends? Because I feel like there's a lot of members of our student body who are struggling to make ends meet and go to school full time, and some of these opportunities seem like they would be fantastic, not only pay-wise, but just career-wise. So, I mean, do you encourage an active student to inquire?
We do. So we actually have a program in place for interns and internships. And they vary. You know, some of the internships we hope to get, you know, 8 hours a day, you know, 5 days a week out of the person. And some of the internships we can tailor to be, you know, part-time. We do have varying shifts. We have a very thin second shift. You know, if there's an opportunity on that off shift and we could accommodate an intern, we'd be very happy to do that. You know, we at Mass Biologics, we're part of the medical school. So we have an educational element built right into our mission. It's part of our mission is to educate the workforce and to create, you know, that more of that infrastructure that stays in this area and kind of creates that inertia that we need. So we're very happy and really encourage those people to apply and learn something about biomanufacturing.
And along the same lines, our Middleborough plant absolutely has a second and third shift. And a lot of the people I work with out of the corporate office right down the street in Lakeville actually started out in the plant and took classes along the way based on whatever their interests were. And then having the plant experience and then going and working corporate is invaluable, especially if you're then working on the plant operations side, the plant management side, at the overseeing all five of our manufacturing plants. Understanding the challenges that's going on at the plant level is you know, something I wish I had.
I was just gonna, if I could just expand on that, I was gonna say the same thing because I've come, you know, through a similar path to a lot of you guys, and it's one thing coming from us as teachers here. This is fantastic because students get to hear from you guys in the industry that I think most of us have come up. I know I started in research changing mouse cages, and that's how I got involved. So I think it's huge for our students to get to hear from you guys. It is possible to work your way up to where you guys are now.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, to add on that, one of the things that I did that was really helpful for me is as I started to think about changing my career path, I went and talked to people that I for whatever reason, thought they were in a really good place in their lives. And I think of not necessarily even mentors, certainly mentors, but just people in at Georgia Tech, professors that were deans of the department had gotten really high up. And I said, how did you get there? And it blew me, it was enlightening to me. Every single one had a winding career path. The chef I worked for at the Culinary Institute, he started out in forestry in Oregon, right? Like no one, shouldn't say no one, hardly anyone takes a straightforward path to where they are.
Yeah, I think that it's important to kind of put away the paradigms, right? So I graduated with a degree in biology, and there were two job openings at a local biotech company, one in manufacturing and one in research and development. And two people from my graduating class, me and one other person, applied for those two jobs. I lost. The other guy got the R&D job, I got the manufacturing job. I got promoted into a production supervisor pretty quickly. After about 5 months, I was promoted to production supervisor. And shortly after that, a job opened up in R&D that I bid on. I wanted to move into R&D because in my mind, that's what you did. You worked in a lab. And here I was in manufacturing, you know, radio labeling nucleotides. And I went to my boss and I said, you know, boy, I'd like this job in R&D. And he said, well, why? And I had no answer. And that's just what I thought I was supposed to do. And he said, look, you know, manufacturing is a science. The scientific principle applies. You know, you're doing science work here. You need somebody who can translate things from the bench and to production scale. It's not going to do anybody good at the bench scale. So I kind of, that little piece of advice, you know, 30 some odd years ago, kind of kicked me off into the operations management side of things.
I have a question for Michael. What specific engineering skills a company such as Ocean Spray interested in?
So what specific engineering skills is a company such as Ocean Spray interested in?
The most important one is problem solving as applied to engineering. So, you know, you need to have the technical background, whether it's in research and development, whether it's in the chemistry side, whether it's in engineering. You need to have the technical background of that field, right? And so there's a certain set of skills that an engineer would have to get into basically an entry-level any engineering position. What gets you far in any position is the problem-solving skills and your people skills. So that's what separates the people that come in and stay at a lower level for a long time from the people that move up through the organization and kind of and follow a high trajectory. Your technical skill set gets you in the door. It's everything else that gets you far in a company.
Can we go ahead and move on? We'll come back to those. I just want to make sure we get everybody, and then we can go to the whole group. So please hold on to those, but we do want to have those. Our next speaker is Brett Hoffmeister. He is the Associate Production Manager at Association of Cape Cod in Falmouth, Massachusetts, an FDA-regulated ISO 13485 registered company that practices CGMP, which is Current Good Manufacturing Practices. Associates at Cape Cod is a manufacturer of LAL, an endotoxin reagent derived from the blood of horseshoe crabs. Brett holds an Associates of Arts in Liberal Arts from Cape Cod Community College. He is also an active member of the Bristol Community College Biotech Advisory Committee. Brett, we'll pass it off to you, please.
Very good. Well, thank you very much for the opportunity to speak with everybody. I am the Associate Manager or Production Manager at Associates of Cape Cod. We are manufacturers of LAL, which is limulus amebocyte lysate derived from the horseshoe crab blood. It's interesting, I think this is a great panel. At least most of these people here use that product, maybe not ours, but one of our competitors. We're only one of four manufacturers in the world that makes this product, and it's basically a test for endotoxin or bacteria that can be harmful. Anything that's injected into the human body, anything that's implanted into the human body that contacts blood, spinal fluid needs to be free of endotoxins. They can be pyrogenic, they can cause you to have a fever, they can be fatal. I'm willing to bet just about every person in this room has been affected by this. If you've ever had a shot, flu shot, had mine this year, it was probably tested by a horseshoe crab blood. Not the individual shot, but the batches. So these guys are, they're not customers, hopefully they will be someday. But it's a very important product, and we've been around for 41 years, right in Falmouth, Massachusetts. Our company was actually the company that was first to be licensed by the FDA. They developed the product almost by accident a long time ago, before I was there. And it's grown over time. And to the point earlier, biotechnology is growing in Boston and around Boston in this world because the population is growing. There's a lot of people on this planet, and they all have health problems, they all need things, and vaccinations, and the miraculous medical devices that we have that can extend and improve life are all dependent on biotechnology and by bioengineering and a lot of things that you guys are interested in. So this is a great field to get into, and I'm really happy to be part of it. I've been with this company for about 13 years now. I came in as a supervisor, and my path was also very non-traditional, I guess. Although the more you talk to people, you find out it's not so odd that you came from different industries. My early careers in life, while I was in high school, I worked in a restaurant like many people. There was no such thing as the internet back then, or was a government secret back then anyway. Nobody had cell phones. The world was a lot smaller place. I got out of high school, and college wasn't a great option for me at the time. And I learned a trade. I got into the printing industry, and I was happy there. It was interesting. It challenged me. It was physically demanding. It gave me a creative side. But I learned things. I learned continuous processes. I learned managing people. I learned deadlines. I learned how to deal with stress. I learned how to stay awake for 24 hours at a clip and learn how to really drive yourself to do things. I became, frankly, very good in that industry. I worked for USA Today. I became one of their best pressmen. I was one of the top in the country, as a matter of fact. And it challenged me, and I was good with that. But as I got older and just became more curious about what else I wanted to do, and I love Cape Cod. I moved to Cape Cod. I quit my job outright. I went back to school. I thought I would own a restaurant someday. My brothers and I were interested in opening a restaurant. So I started taking some business courses, and I started a career towards business. I was fortunate enough to run into a gentleman that was opening a restaurant. I said, I want to learn everything. So I worked the back of the house, the front of the house. I worked the bar. I worked with the accountants. I helped develop the menu, and I was very fortunate. to do that and learn that. I don't want to be in the restaurant business. It's tough. It is tough. And like it was stated earlier, if you've ever worked in the kitchen or worked with the general public, it's one of the toughest jobs there is. And to this day, I mean, I hire a lot of people, and I see on their resume that they've worked in the kitchen, they've worked in a restaurant, they moved right to the top of the list. I want to talk to these folks because I know that they can deal with a lot of this, the stresses I know they've dealt with. And that's a tough business. But it was here that I met my wife. One thing led to another. We got married. We bought a home, and I needed another job. And I went back into printing, which by this point was very clear was a dinosaur. It was a dying industry. I had a child, I had a mortgage, and I was looking for something else to do. And whether it found me or I found it, I'm still not sure, but one day I went down to see this company. I knew about them. I knew that they bled horseshoe crabs. They did this crazy thing. I always loved the ocean. I was a diver as a kid, a scuba diver. I always liked poking things. I was very inquisitive. And I went in, I literally knocked on the door and wanted to speak to somebody in HR, and I introduced myself. And 2 weeks later, I talked them into hiring me. This was a company that was under transition. They were growing from a small plant into a very big plant. The FDA had given them some guidance. They needed to move out of a small building into a modern one, and they needed people like me to help bring that from the bench into production. The continuous processes, the management that I learned of people skills allowed me to get a supervisory role here. The ServSafe certificate that I earned working in the restaurant helped teach me a lot about cross-contamination that, you know, 20 years later become very important. And in this business, cross-contamination is king. I mean, we cannot bring bacteria and viruses and mold and things into the manufacturing industry or into the manufacturing of these products. So it was a number of things throughout my life that brought me into this industry and gave me the opportunity that I have now, and I'm very grateful for it. And you know, one of the best aspects of my job, one of the things that I really enjoy about it, is the fact that we rely on a large group of young people to help us in the summer. So I'm putting in a plug here. We are actively seeking people right now for employment in the summer. So there are jobs available. You know, horseshoe crabs come into the beaches, they come inshore. After the winter, they come in the spring in large numbers, and this is when the fishermen collect them and when we collect the blood. And basically what we do is inside of clean rooms, we collect a little bit of the blood from the horseshoe crabs. It's not fatal. We centrifuge the blood and we isolate the white blood cells. And we begin a process of washing those white blood cells and bursting them to release these clotting agents that they have. Horseshoe crabs in the wild, if they're injured, their blood clots up. Similar to ours, it clots up, stops the bleeding, isolates its bacteria, and it kind of sloughs off. There's also some inhibitors that prevent the rest of the blood from clotting. There's other agents that promote healing. Not unlike our own immune systems, but this is very primitive. And what we're able to do is isolate some of the proteins and enzymes within those white blood cells. We learn to manipulate it, make it a little more sensitive, a little less sensitive. We can add light reagents to it. We can make it sensitive to fungus. And then we put it into a vial and freeze dry it and turn it into a white powder. So we've got a little vial of white powder, and customers like this here will use that product. They'll buy it from us, they'll buy it in a kit. We'll also sell them sterile water. They can reconstitute that, turn it back into this manipulated horseshoe crab blood, add an equal amount of their flu vaccination or their TD vaccine, and wait about an hour and see if it clots up, and that would show the presence of gram-negative bacteria. So this replaces the old test where they would inject a rabbit and wait to see if it got sick or died. It might take a couple of days. We can offer a test right now that give you results in about an hour at a fraction of the cost and exponentially more accurate. This test can detect bacteria in parts per billion. It's extremely sensitive. So it was a game changer when it was invented, and right now it's the gold standard. It's required by law that these products are tested for endotoxin, and this is the best way to do it. So very happy to be part of that. You know, we offer a great internship through Bristol Community, working with other colleges right now, because students that are interested in this industry have a vested interest in learning things. And the industry, the biotech, biomedical industry, is looking for people with experience. You need not only the academic experience or education, you should have some hands-on experience, and we can offer that through the internships and our summer employment, where you actually come in and you'll draw blood from horseshoe crabs. You learn to walk the walk and talk the talk in an FDA regulated facility, practicing cGMP, some of the buzzwords you've heard today, these are good things to learn and apply later in life. It's a great opportunity to build a resume, and we hire a lot of people. We call them bleeders. I've had people that come back. Ultimately, 2, 3, 4 years I look for people. I invest a lot of time in the people I work with and their education and making sure that they learn and progress and move forward in the company. It betters me, makes me feel good. The intrinsic values I get from seeing people move forward is good. But it betters them, and you know, unfortunately, I also see a lot of people move on, but they get into this industry that's big in this area, that's critical to our population, quite frankly, and it's quite interesting. It's nice to be part of something that helps people. I'm not just building a cog, you know, I'm doing something that I'm very proud of doing, and I strongly recommend this industry. It's good to see people like you here today interested in it, and I'm happy to be here representing it, as I think everybody is. It's a good industry to be in, and it's nice work conditions. It pays well, generally pays well, good benefits. It's a good place to be.
All right, our next speaker, Andrea, and I hope I get your name right, Andrea Pastias. Say it again.
Pastias.
Yes, I'm not even getting close. Sorry. Andrea works for Primo Medical Group as a senior executive vice president. Primo Medical Group designs, develops, manufactures, and assembles medical devices and is an original equipment manufacturer. And I think the key thing here that I wanted people to kind of walk away with is Andrea is a graduate of New Bedford High School and went on to earn her undergraduate degrees in special education and elementary education from Bridgewater State College, followed by a master's degree in counseling from Northeastern University. So I think she's going to give us a very interesting career path that she followed to get where she is today as well.
Right. So when I graduated from high school, I was the first generation graduate of high school in my family. My father was from another country, from Greece, and my mother didn't graduate from high school, but they always told us, there were 6 of us, that we could do whatever we wanted. So when I was in third grade, I thought I wanted to be a teacher. This is gonna be my career path. I had a third grade teacher that I loved, and I wanted to do this. So I went to school, got a degree in education, in special education, and thought, maybe I don't really want to do this. So I applied to Northeastern. I was not a math and science person at all. So my background, I never put things together. I didn't know how to put together Legos. It was not something that I ever imagined. So I went to Northeastern and got a degree in counseling. I thought, all right, this is it. I'm going to be a counselor. And while I was in counseling, I helped. I worked at Perkins School for the Blind, and I helped college-educated, blind, and visually impaired adults work in the Boston workforce. So I had to do a lot of business courses so that I could go in and train people in businesses how to work with visually impaired adults. And I started to really like the training and the business side of it. So when I graduated, I thought I would get a job in counseling. And a friend of mine, whose father owned a small manufacturing house, 10 people, all machine shop, it was basically one machine shop, asked me if I wanted to work in sales because he wanted to build up his sales and marketing and kind of grow the company. So because I didn't have any other option, I took the job. I started doing things like cold calling, going to big medical device companies to try and get business. You know, I was a machine shop, I needed business. We were military aerospace machining, so we made stuff for the military aerospace industry. I was the first woman at the company who wasn't a secretary, so when something needed to be typed or faxed, they always came to me, at which point I would say, I don't know how to type. It was hard. It was hard to be a woman in a field with all men, especially seeing I didn't have any manufacturing background. So I decided that I needed to learn, so I started asking machinists to show me how to set up jobs. I had engineers show me how to read blueprints, and I just kind of, I wasn't great, but I could get my way, you know, find my way around. So I reinvented myself. I started in education and ended up in a manufacturing house. After the end of the Cold War, the manufacturing business died. I mean, we were going to completely go out of business if we didn't reinvent ourselves. So we decided to get into the medical device business. We started looking at companies like Johnson & Johnson. What can we do for you? So we learned how to manufacture things for medical companies. And we built clean rooms. We used LAL testing, like Brett's company offered. And we reinvented ourselves. We have a large machine shop. We have engineers. We have quality engineers. We have manufacturing engineers, design engineers, a little bit of everything. And then we decided that in medical devices, the real way to make money and be successful is to create our own devices. So instead of just manufacturing for someone like Johnson & Johnson, we wanted to create our own devices. So we started asking people in the company, do you have any ideas? Do you have, is there anything that we could do that could make a difference in the world in medical devices? So our we did spin-off companies. So our first spin-off company was a cardiology device. Someone came to us, one of our employees, with an idea. He said, if we could close the femoral artery after coronary angioplasty, that would be great. And so we put engineers on it. We spun out the company. We raised $30 million and built this whole new device, completely separate of Primo Medical Group. We did everything that needed to be done to create a product that we turned around and sold to Medtronic. And we've done that 6 times. So we have cardiology, orthopedics, GI, a little bit of everything. So we reinvented ourselves again. So I started in education, then we were a machine shop, and then we went into medical manufacturing, and then from there we did the spin-off model, which in turn helped our company grow. So when I started, we were under $1 million in sales, and now we're a $50 million company. So a lot of it is from the innovation that we did. Innovation is not dead in the United States, and I think that's really important to know. I've traveled all over the world. We do clinical work in Paraguay and South America. I've been to 6 continents, and there is nothing like America. So if you're sitting there thinking, I wish I lived in another place, it's better, they have better healthcare, they have better opportunity, I'm telling you, the United States is where it is, and especially this area, because we have the hospitals and we have doctors. I have doctors come to us every week with an idea that they want us to create a company around, and it's because we're doing it. We're actually coming up and working with these doctors and these hospitals and coming up with products that make a difference. So as engineering students or machine shop, working in a machine shop, which is really, there's a big need for machinists in this area, in my company. It's hands-on. Somebody has to, you can come up with the greatest idea, you have a doctor, they have all these brilliant ideas, but someone has to make it. And it's the careers that you're going into or thinking of going into that help us do what we want to do. So I think it's important to know that you can do anything. And when you get into a company, it's important to want to learn everything. Learn how to do purchasing, learn how to do quality, learn how to read prints and do manufacturing. Things that might not be part of what you want to do in the end will help you along the way, because the more knowledge that you have, the better. I think that the other thing that's important that is really not school related and I think will make you a well-rounded person is volunteering. I think volunteering is critical. It helps you, it just rounds you out. It gives you the opportunity to help other people, other organizations that maybe aren't in your field grow. And I say that because I think that volunteering is really, really important. And I know it's hard if you're working and you have, you're going to school, you think, how can I possibly do it? There's always time. There's always time to help others. And I think that's it. My brain is a little fogged. I just flew in from California this morning. So I think that's important. I think it's important to know that you can change your mind. One of my sons was in college, great his freshman year. Failed classes his sophomore year, so we pulled him. And I said, I'm not paying for you to go to college. It's you know, this Appian unscrewed me out of the ceiling. I said, you need to figure this out. And so he got a job in a sweatshop, and what he said was a sweatshop. And then he was supposed to go back to school in the fall, and he said, I'm not going back. I'm gonna move to the Galapagos Islands, and I'm gonna volunteer. I said, all right, and he did. He moved to the Galapagos Islands. He worked as an English teacher in a school, and he came back, and now he's back in school. So he, even at a young age, he kind of screwed up, and then he got back on track. And I think it's important to know that you can always get back on track, no matter what. Whether you drop out of college and you get a job and you think, this is where I'm stuck for the rest of my life, it is not. There is always a way to succeed. So that's my
I just shut it off. I'm sorry.
No, it's okay.
Okay, so we have two questions here. Real quick, get behind the mic.
Okay, I'd just like to say it's very encouraging, by the way, to hear how fluid it can be and how many wings each of your departments have. You know, as a freshman, not really knowing what degree to go into, you pick one and you get into a job and you can be fluid. And my specific question was to Frank with the gene injection. That's something very cutting edge. What kind of draws me to science and biotechnology? And that must open up a lot of research opportunities for you to kind of get past laws and such. I would say.
Right. So the science side of that is kind of the typical, you know, biological. Oh, thank you. The typical biological science, right? So you're doing the discovery work in a laboratory somewhere, but you brought up an interesting point. You know, all of the regulatory path for how do you bring a product like that to market, and how do you bring it to the people who need the drug? That's all brand new. We got to figure all that out, right? You're actually sitting in front of our deputy director for clinical affairs. So what she does is she designs all of the clinical trials that we're going to use to bring these medicines and demonstrate to the FDA that these medicines are safe and effective. That's great for medicines that are traditional, and the FDA understands. When you have a new type of medicine, well, what do those clinical trials look like? You know, and where are you going to get the people to ask those questions and set that regulatory path?
Okay, one more question to the gentleman in the back. Unfortunately, we've run out of time, so I just want to open the floor to that one gentleman and then let everybody know what we can do is reconvene over here in the little cafe for a little bit of networking if anybody has any follow-up questions for the speakers or with Megan or myself. So, gentlemen, sir, did you have a question?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah, no.
First of all, I want to thank everyone for being here and taking time out of your day that actually helped us with everything. My question involves the internships. There's a co-op program here that students work through. It's an actual class that people take. What I was wondering is it a necessity through your company to work as part of the co-op program, or are you open?
So is it necessary to work through the co-op program here at BCC, or would you take interns outside of the organized cooperative education program?
This year I posted an internship up on our corporate website that got picked up by Monster, Indeed, LinkedIn, all those websites, and went out nationally. And we ended up, we've already selected our intern for my team this year, picked up someone out of Virginia Tech that she just found it through, I believe, Monster. So, you know, absolutely not. We do have an engineering co-op that works through something specific like that, but we also have internships that are just posted.
At Mass Biologics, you don't have to work through that co-op program. You will take interns, you know, whether you've gone through the program or not. It's a great class, by the way. You should take it. I've heard about this, and it's absolutely critical that you guys take this class. But you don't have to have taken it to get the internship.
Yeah.
whether it's through school or on your own, I mean, any work experience is good work experience. Just to give you a perception of, you know, what actually goes on in whichever plant or position that you you encounter. So, you know, in my experience, I chose not to do a co-op program. Typical co-op programs, they could extend your studies. Some universities, it's built into their program. You know, they may be a five-year institution. I chose to work on my own only so that I wouldn't derail, you know, the four-year degree process, which was derailed a year anyway. So, again, any work experience, right, is good work experience.
And for us, you know, the internships are actually something that's relatively new. We've been doing this now for about 3 years. 90% of the people we have come in are not on internships. They're coming in as seasonal employees, but it is an opportunity to get some hands-on experience. And, you know, benefit to everybody if you can get credit for that, but it's not required by any means.
All right, thank you everybody for being here today.